Yesterday I was so wiped out, I could hardly talk. That's the sign of the times right now, that the pressure is so intense. But I do have some extreme clarifications here in this video for you. Indeed, the escape, I said it was to the right side, the extreme right side. I'm not talking about politics, I'm talking about hemispheres of the brain. Right brain hemisphere, what is that, intuitive, holistic, that kind of thing. We need to go to the very farthest reaches of that, the extreme right brain, as it were, entirely. That is where the escape actually can be found. I know what the escape is. I'm very clear about the whole thing. But I've always said, you know, it would sure help if there was somebody in the world that could embody that escape. And, you know, I know Muji's doing his thing as best he can. If somebody's in the world, they may have to tape to so many, you know, as many people as possible can benefit from it. It's difficult to travel now. A lot of people may not be able to travel. And we need to get it right now, fast. There is a remedy. There's absolutely a remedy. I'm 100% sure there's a remedy. And I've been speaking of it. The centerless self, the self without a center. The symbolless symbol, okay? The symbol that symbolizes no symbol is another way to put it. There's a lot of ways to put it, but however we put it, it's this right brain experience that we need. Rather than the left brain. Well, the left brain can talk about it and symbolize it and play with the symbols and all this kind of stuff, but it doesn't realize it. It's the right brain, quote-unquote, right brain experience of the totality of it. Right brain's able to grasp the whole thing in the totality of it, instead of nitpicking and quibbling and trying to rearrange everything and all the, give explanations and figuring it out. That's more left brain. So, temporarily, I say, here's a mantra. I'm temporarily symptom-free. I'm temporarily symptom-free. Okay, I'm temporarily symptom-free. Now, I use the term temporarily and symptom-free very purposefully, because saying you're symptom-free doesn't say you're cured, okay, because the ego will then fight you on that. And you say, I'm temporarily, it doesn't mean you're insisting this is permanent, because it'll fight you on that too. So if you say, I'm temporarily symptom-free, that is a better way of getting past the objections. So the centerless self, have there been those in the world with this centerless self? Yes, absolutely there have been. And the testimony of others is they simply sit there with them and they begin to feel, they shift right brain, they go right brain and then they go extreme right brain. See, very important is we're not trying to balance the two hemispheres here, okay? This is the problem. For sure this is the problem. I'm telling you that it's not just the left brain that's the problem. It's trying to balance the two and equally that's the problem. Because the escape from the mad whimsicality of existence, really the situation we're in, is extreme right brain functioning. You know, totally holistic vision. Totally holistic vision. And again, we don't need to see the problems of the world at all. All we need is to see, be reminded of reality. There's nothing we need to do with the world as far as changing it. Absolutely nothing, except to see, give it our perception, a different usage. In other words, project upon the world a perception where everything is perfect, where everything is immaculate. Everything is overlaid without any specialness, any concentration. Okay, perfect overlay. That reminds us of reality, and then we're able to set down all of existence, all of perception, and then there's no problems at all. So this is the difficult part, that the left hemisphere are trying to balance the two out, left and right, just can't get it. It can't get that. It doesn't understand it. This is an extreme right brain type of understanding. Extreme. All the way, as far as you can possibly go, to into the right brain, holistic way of viewing things. And so the way I'm talking comes from that. But we have to literally experience it. And again, not trying to balance it out with the left brain. That's like saying you're trying to balance truth and lies. Why would anyone want to do that? You know? No. Trying to balance freedom and enslavement. Why would we do that? Why try to balance suffering and bliss? Why? Again, the only real purpose we can give to illusion is to remind us of reality. That's it. So, there absolutely is a way for this to be done. And there have been those in the past that have done it. And it would sure help now if we have those right now who are this abiding as this, or with this centerless self. The centerless self. Can the knower be known? Why do we need a knower? If there's just knowing, do we need a knower? Do we really need a knower? You see, these are questions that are coming from this place of safety, really, and escape, and freedom from madness and misery and suffering. Do we need an I? Do we need a center? Do we need a center in the world? Or can we see a world without a center? Can we perceive a world without a center? Without a seer? Can we just have pure seeing instead of a seer doing the seeing, is the question. Does knowing need to be known? Does it need to have a knower of the knowing? Really, does knowing really need to have a knower? Or is trying to have a knower a way to try and destroy knowing, actually? So can we perceive a world where there is no center to the world? Can we perceive a universe without a center? Can we see without there being a seer? Can there be seeing without being a seer? Now, if there can be, then since the only point of any of this is to be reminded of reality, we don't have to actually be that. We need to be reminded of that so we can abide with that. The seer can abide with seeing without a seer. But it's not trying to combine the two, okay? It's not trying to combine the two. No, we're not trying to come up with a hybrid here. We're simply, our experience of having a seer doing the seeing is now getting, we're now getting familiar with that we can have seeing without a seer. And this familiarity then solves the continuity issue, and then we can set down the seer. We don't need a seer for seeing to, we don't need a knower for knowing to be. But we're not trying to join the two. Okay, it's super important. That's why abidance is the key word, is we sit next to it. We have these two experiences, and we gradually realize, hey, there's this other one. We don't really need a seer in order for there to be seeing. See, seeing is total. Knowing is total. There's no exceptions to it. So there's no need for a knower. And in other words, truth doesn't need a head. The world doesn't need a center. Doesn't need a knower. Doesn't need a seer. Perception doesn't really need a seer. No. On and on and on and on. We get these things coming from this extreme, the farthest, you know, right brain, holistic recognitions. But we have to actually go through with it. And that's where we all come up short, because we keep going back to the left brain and saying, you know, you got to come with me, you got to come with me. For somehow we can't quite, you know, get up those stairs and get it done. So whenever a crisis arises, I'm aware that we're coming up short, and we all are. We're coming up short. We're coming up short. And it should be very simple. I mean, it's just, the first thing to do is recognize that we're coming up short. We're coming up short. We're not trying to blend mutual exclusives. We're trying to get to the entirely complete, pure, right brain vision. People will say, well, you're deficient in left brain. Remember, this experience is not an end in itself. It's only an attempt to remind us of reality. A reminder. And that's all we need. So we don't need to catalog it. We don't need to be experiencing any of the world's problems at all, actually. How does that help us? Not at all. Not at all. Do any of the world's problems need to be resolved? No, none of them do. Nothing needs to be resolved. Because resolving them doesn't help us remember reality. There's no problems in reality. There's no resolutions taking place in reality. How does resolving problems help us at all? It doesn't. So we don't need to be reminded, don't need to work on any problem, resolving any problems, except the continuity issue, which is just a practical, pragmatic issue. And we do that simply by being reminded of reality. Reality doesn't have a center. There's no center in reality. So, subjectively, as we go about, we feel that there's a seer in what is being seen. And this does not remind us of reality. But we don't need to get rid of the seer, okay? We don't need to. We don't need to get rid of this. We simply need to abide with the seerless seeing. With the centerless self. We don't need to get rid of this, of the notion of a self. We need to just abide with the centerless self. Because we're not aiming to attain a state. Our aim is to be reminded of reality. So it's not a question of attainment. That's why I say temporarily. Very important. We say, I temporarily am without any symptoms. I'm not being troubled. I'm temporarily symptom-free. I'm temporarily symptom-free. This is a better way. If the left brain is what reports back to others, supposedly there are others, you know, whatever, reports back and can say, this is what I'm experiencing. And yet we have to be very careful not to get engaged, the left hemisphere, get too engaged, because that will then pull you out of the experience, easily pull you out of it. And the world really has extremely bad mental habits, very, very bad. One of them is to continue asking questions instead of contemplating the answers that have already been given. What do you think about this? Well, if that's true, what about this? If that's true, and it just keeps on talking in this way, avoiding consideration of what's already been said and answered. This is a horrible mental habit. Many, many mental habits we have that are actually super, super bad for us, and we have to break those habits, actually. But people are in the grip of these habits, and they just, you know, can't seem to get any leverage on them whatsoever. They just keep functioning in this habitual way. Krishnamurti pointed that out, and he also pointed out back in the was it 50s maybe, that there would be a generation of godless, materialistic atheists who are super effective at organizing their materiality. And they would come into this world and take it over. And he's turned out to be exactly right, which is what has happened right now. Okay, we have this godless, atheistic materialists who have taken over the world. And you've just seen the tip of the iceberg of what's actually happening. There, the whole notion of their plan is to create a secular paradise here. And it's to, in order to do that, they want to break down all the barriers between different groups and factions, etc. And what they say is that in order to do that, we have to get, they have to get rid of religion, because they say that creates conflicts between different countries and nations and peoples. So what they've done is they introduce a secular language. Okay, they've tried to secularize the world, saying that this language of secularity is a common ground between everybody, and that they will enable them to bring, get the, you know, one world order. United Nations has always had this as its purpose. And they blatantly say, hey, look, we got to get rid of the language of religion, the language of spiritual teachings, etc., and get the secular language involved. So it's taught in schools all over the world. It's all done on purpose. It's all done on purpose. So, it was just seeing the tip of the iceberg. They aim to eliminate religion. Okay, eliminate it. And there's a ferocious war taking place over that. So, the times are changing faster than we can imagine. There's some, like I noticed, some DVD they're selling now that blocks all religious content from playing on it. You know, that should get people's attention. That's where we're headed. We're headed towards a purging, a great, you know, you talk about communist takeovers and there's a big purge, right? There's going to be a global purge, and that is to purge religion from the planet. That's the aim of it. Very left hemisphere activity, actually. The right hemisphere doesn't have any trouble with different approaches, etc. Like, no, it doesn't bother too much at all. It rests secure in its own awareness of what the answer is. It doesn't feel threatened by that way, in that way at all. It doesn't feel a need to create a one world governance or anything like that. It doesn't feel a need to solve any of the problems. In fact, it knows the problems that arise from duality, from delusion, are not solvable at all. You can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't have insanity and have it solved at the same time, because then it's no longer insanity. You can't have an illusion and have no illusion at the same time. It's not possible. You can't have symbols and symbol freeness at the same time. You can't have nothing and everything at the same time. These things are not attainable. When we, eternal life cannot die. That's not attainable. So the problems arise when we're trying to attain the unattainable. Really. So the right brain way of talking, etc., is just a shock to the traditional society right now. Sort of a very regressive society, actually. They don't understand the language at all. So there is a rush, there is a timeline, there is a rush to get this done. There most definitely is. And that's what causes me agitation, is very clearly you can read the tea leaves and see what's going on. There's constant now purging. There's a massive purge going on. Lies are replacing truth. The bigger the lie, the better the world thinks. When people get caught in big lies, they just, you know, oh, you know, that's no big deal. Don't whine about it or something. We're not talking about mistakes, honest mistakes, or mistakes made in haste or something. We're talking about, you know, the big lie, big lies. To introduce this, you know, global order, this and this purge. The purge is coming. The purge has been taking place for a long time, actually. And it will get more and more and more and more intense, actually. Which is why you have these arguments breaking out. So we need to get it done. It's not happening. It's not getting done. And it should be getting done. I don't have an answer for why it's not getting done. We should be able to abide in this right brain realization. We should be able to abide within the centerless. It's not a big deal. It should not be difficult for us. You can talk about society, this society, all that, blah, 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 but even then, it should not be difficult. What the problem is, I'm trying to see, is that people will say, okay, but how does that help solve the world's problems? It doesn't. It doesn't at all. It's kind of like there's this dream of a catastrophe, and then you wake up and realize you're dreaming, and then you say, wait a minute, I gotta go stop this catastrophe. Is that what you would say? No. It's like, instead of solving the problems, you realize that the problems don't affect you. You're not affected by the problems. In other words, is the reminder of reality affected by the world's problems? Let's put it that way. The answer is no. No, not even death affects it. Nothing affects it. So then how are they problems? Are they real problems? Are they blocking us? No, we're not being blocked. We are not being blocked. This is the crucial insight that, let's say we're going along a road and there's mountains on one side, like the Pacific Ocean, going down the Big Sur coast, and there's steep mountains on one side, and then the ocean, Pacific Ocean, on the other side of the road, and there's just no wiggle room anywhere. And you're driving along, and a landslide happens, and the road is completely, you know, blocked by this landslide. And you say, oh my gosh. And then you say, oh, I got a huge problem. What do I do? I need to get to Esalen or something, you know. I need some body workers, you know, whatever. And I can't get there. I can't get to Esalen. Driving down to Esalen on the Big Sur coast. And attend some, you know, Rolfing or I don't know, whatever, Reiki, whatever they could do, whatever they're doing now. And you can't get there. And it's like, oh, you're just like going crazy. How do I get this landslide? And you're digging with your hands and, you know, and just trying to use it, maybe a shovel, try to get rid of it, and it's just way too much. You can't do it. Big boulders are there. You can't move the boulders. It's terrible. Now somebody comes along and says, "What's the problem?" They say, "Oh, look at this landslide." And I say, "Okay, look, come here, and walk over here." And there's a bench there, and the bench is overlooking the Pacific. Okay, so I say, "Sit down on the bench and look out here at the Pacific Ocean." Okay, and then. And then something like happens where the atmosphere becomes like just unbelievably beautiful, wonderful, perfect. Everything looks perfect, feels perfect. You're just looking at this incredible perfection. And you say, well, this is great, you know, but what about the landslide? And you're getting, your friend says, look, the whole point, why were you going to Esalen in the first place? You're trying to remember reality, right? You're trying to remember home, okay? So this vision here you're experiencing, that is the reminder of home. That's what reminds you of home. So you don't need to clear the landslide and get down to Esalen. You see, you don't need to do that. Therefore, it's not a problem for you. It's not a problem for you. It's like that. It's like that. Yeah. There's a block coming up in the world. Yeah, the road is blocked ahead, for sure. And we know that these people are working to block it as frantically as possible, to make it unnavigable. It doesn't matter, because right here, right now, where you are, this centerless self, the centerless center, this symbol of no symbols, is available and present for us, and we can experience it. And that reminds us of reality, which is all we need. Because then we say, hey, we don't even need all this, any of this perception at all, none of it. And it's all a dream, actually. So, it's exactly like that. We don't need to fight anybody. We don't need to fight the landslide. We don't need to fight the roadblock. That's what doesn't work, actually. We don't need to defeat anybody. There's a reason why Jesus said, turn the other cheek. He was, you know, he's just not a nice guy. That's not what it was about. No, nothing like that. He is saying, here's the way. There's the way that works is, don't oppose the Roman occupation. Don't oppose Caesar, taxation. Don't oppose what the world is doing. Instead, accept the Christ child, which is the centerless self. Accept the inner Christ child within that reminds us of reality. And then you'll say, oh, all this perception, it doesn't, it has no effect on me whatsoever. It doesn't matter. I've already been reminded of reality. That's all I need. That's all I need. Now, the early Christians were martyred, a lot of them, and they said, it doesn't matter. What they said was, look, I already have the vision of Christ. I've already been reminded of reality. I don't even need a body. I don't need a body to experience this world. What is a body but perception? And they say, I'm already having this divine perception that reminds me of reality. So death is what the death of this, I'm not even using this perception. It doesn't even bother me in the slightest bit. It's irrelevant, isn't it? No, I'm not inconvenienced by it in any way. And those are the real Christians, you know. So there is something to religion. And what these people in the modern world are fanatically against is, they don't want anyone to realize that. Might make them feel inferior or something, you know, that they have an inferiority complex. They want to say there's no such thing, no such thing exists. Of course, they ignore all the evidence entirely and then claim that they're intelligent. What we really have in this world is a lack of intelligence, a severe lack of intelligence here, incredibly severe. And Krishnamurti again was right. He said that's what's going to happen. And Krishnamurti was in touch with his inner Christ child, absolutely. And this information was conveyed to him, saying, "Hey, this is what is coming." And he was, you know, it was correct. It was very accurate. See, now was Krishnamurti? I mean, he still liked to drive fancy cars real fast, you know, and to wear nice suits. I mean, he still had a personality and everything, but he was able to abide with the centerless self, with this Christ child. He was able to abide there, you know. He was able to. And so he had this, you know, very exalted radiance about him, and was able to give us very good advice. Now, do we need to stop these deficient ones, the ones who are deficient in wisdom and intelligence, ones with the bad habits? No, we don't need to stop them. It's sure it's a landslide, a roadblock, but it doesn't matter. Where we are, sit down and abide with the centerless self, Christ child within, and it doesn't matter then, at that point. This is, Jesus said, turn the other cheek, don't try and defeat the Roman Empire. That's the wrong way. That's what he's saying. And this advice is good for all time, forever. You don't need to do anything to the world. Make it better, make it worse, don't need to do anything. Because the world will never remind us of reality, because it's our perception of it is the problem. So we have to literally have a new perception of the world. Jesus said you can't enter the kingdom of heaven unless you're born again, meaning unless you have a new perception of the world. Now, you don't have to get rid of your old perception. as far as functioning, but you need to abide, temporarily abide with the new perception and get used and recognize it's there. It's there and get familiar with it. So you can still converse, you can still talk. Someone says your name, you can still respond to it. If someone sees you as a self with a center, you can still acknowledge that their viewpoint and everything. That's not a problem. No, that's a problem. It's just that we can abide with this center of the self. And again, temporarily, because it's temporary too. So these things can be explained. They can be explained, but we have to experience it actually. Otherwise, it's no good. And I've not been able to, it hasn't yet been experienced with me, and very few actually are actually abiding with that. And they don't seem to be, there doesn't seem to be an outreach, really. And so, of course, people are nervous at this time, definitely nervous. One moment, please. So this purge is coming. So there is this massive purge happening. So of course, it's like if you were in Nazi Germany and all this stuff started happening, as a Jew, you would say, you know what, we got to get out of this place. Or China, same type of thing, or wherever, there's a takeover of a dictatorship and a purging taking place. You know, you say, wow, we got this, you know, we needed help. And in this case, it's a global purge. So the necessity is for this abidance, temporary abidance, to take place, to go right brain all the way to the furthest extent of the right brain, not just partial right brain, all the way to the most farthest reaches of right brain hemisphere functioning, so to speak, completely holistic, centerless self. A world, perceive a world without a center. Perceive a world without a seer. Or at least temporarily abide with that. Temporary abidance. Temporary abidance. Don't get caught up saying, well, I'm gonna see this permanently. The ego will then flip you. You know, it's jiu-jitsu on you. It's very clever, the ego. See, this is temporary abidance here. Temporary abidance. And the right brain can deal with this situation. These answers have been coming up for me, but we're so habituated to caving into a balance between the two that we just almost default to that when we're pressured. We give up the extreme right brain. Say, okay, let's rip for something in the middle somewhere here, and then we lose it. It's gone. So I've always said that it just stands to reason that there'll be some very, very helpful beings coming to the world, but I haven't found them. I have not found them. So, you know, it's not looking great at this point, which is hard to fathom, because the purging is definitely full on right now. And Jesus told us this is exactly what's going to happen. Just what Krishnamurti said, Jesus said 2,000 years ago. That we would run into this time, and we're here. We are absolutely, you know, sinking, going below the water in these times. It's funny. You get this war between Yahoo, Google, and the big, you know, tech companies with the Fed, NSA. The NSA spying on Google and Yahoo and stuff. What they fail to say is that Google and Yahoo are spying on all of us. You know, right? That somehow that slips through the cracks. They're both, it's spy versus spy. You know, back in the old Mad Magazine days, spy versus spy. I mean, Google and Yahoo, Google is scanning all our emails, checking out every single last thing we do online. But all those tech companies are completely invading our privacy 100%. And yet they're outraged that the NSA is culling through their, you know, data stream. At least the NSA is purported, you know, hopefully trying to foil terrorist plots. Whereas these Google and Yahoo, they're just trying to, you know, who knows what they're trying to do in the end agenda. I mean, we can talk about it, but they're trying to pigeonhole you and market you and, you know, turn you into a, you know, almost like a robotic consumer number, so to speak. So, hey, it's funny, the pot calling the kettle black here. But overall, the purge is on extreme. It's extreme, and it's only going to get more extreme. Now, the Titanic, when the Titanic went down, what happened? Hit an iceberg. The iceberg was in the place it shouldn't have been, okay? It was too far south. You know, it was not on, icebergs have a track, and it was off track. It was off track. And so the Titanic, I don't know how many smokestacks the Titanic has, either maybe three or five, or I don't know, three, four, five, whatever. But it hit this iceberg and went down. Now, we talk about, Jesus said there'll be a cosmic catastrophe at the end of this age. So it's going to come from either, you know, some sort of space rock, probably, or a coronal mass ejection or something. And he said it'll come like a thief in the night. You won't see it coming. It'll just be, you know, sneak up on you totally. So, you know, look out for these times. It's funny that people say, well, you can't spread fear. You know, well, who spread more fear than Jesus, to tell you the truth, telling us about this end times catastrophe, and we must prepare and be vigilant. All his parables are being, be vigilant, prepare, don't get sucked into the, you know, this godless atheistic materialism. In other words, warning. Now, that's not spreading fear. It's telling you what's up and saying, be prepared. All his parables, be prepared. What if a comet gets off track? You know, what if something causes it to get off track somehow? Worst case scenario. Now, we're living in a time of worst case scenarios. We had the Indonesian, the Boxing Day, the tsunami. We had Katrina before that. We had the Gulf oil spill. Then we had the Fukushima tsunami. And we've had a lot of situations recently that which have been worst case scenarios, actually. Stuff that said, wow, we could have hardly written a worse script for what happened. So we're expecting the cosmos to what? To obey our scripts? We say, oh no, we have it all scripted and it's going to obey our best script. Well, we had it all scripted down the Gulf of Mexico too. But all sorts of stuff went wrong. And we had that horrible oil spill, right? So, you know, in Katrina, a lot of people said, we've had plenty of these hurricanes. They're always, nothing ever happens. No problem, you know. So, you cannot rely on science entirely. They're wrong, what, about 80% of the time? So it's possible. It's possible at some point something cosmically catastrophic is going to happen on this planet, for sure. I know that. Now, I don't know exactly when. But we should, all the more reason for everything that's happening in the world is to realize that what happens in the world doesn't matter. And we don't need to stop anything from happening. That's what the enlightened ones, they just keep on living their life. Say, why aren't you trying to change the world? They said, no, it doesn't matter. I just go on living my life just the way it was, whatever. That's not the point. use perception to help free us from perception. And this has to be a centerless self, a world without a center, perfect overlay, as it were. You know, there's no center, there's no centricness to it. Seeing without a seer. Awareness, knowing without a knower. As Franklin Merrill Wolf said, consciousness without an object. Or he might have said, consciousness without a subject also. Or consciousness without subject-object. Some say pure consciousness, pure awareness, pure space. But is that really space or consciousness or, you know? Does a centerless center have a center? Or a centerless self have a self? Well, all these things are only reminders. So we don't need to solve these things. You know, conceptually, it's not necessary to solve these. We have the so-called conceptual paradox. Is a self without a center, is that a self? It doesn't matter, conceptually. I mean, left brain doesn't have to get it. All right, it's very important to hear this. The left brain doesn't have to get it, doesn't need to get it. So there's no purpose, because all we have to get is be reminded of reality. Not to figure it out, not to get it, but to be reminded of it. So then we can set down the whole notion of getting anything, because the knowing doesn't need to be known. See, the whole thing about we think we need to, there needs to be a knower, something to get knowing, something is wrong. That is the delusion. Reality doesn't need to get itself. And so we are stuck with this continuity issue, thinking that there needs to be a seer, you know, there needs to be a knower. It does not. So how do we bridge this continuity gap? By abiding with that, the Christ child sitting, you know, beside us. Now the ego tries to block this. Let's say you're having a talent contest, like, what is it, American Idol, or, you know, all these talent contests they have all over the place, right? And so let's say you're on the judging panel, and you have all these contestants coming, and you're judging, okay. And then there's one last contestant. And I say, okay, next contestant. And the other contestants suddenly jump up and say, no. No, we don't want them to come on stage. It's like, why, what's up? They're no good, they're terrible. Believe me, they're really terrible. It's a waste of your time, it's a waste of our time. We want you to judge us. We don't want you to judge that other one, because it's a waste of your time. They have no talent whatsoever, we guarantee you. And then as judge, you say, well, wait a minute, let I'm the judge, let me decide. And they say, no, we know, we're talent, we're performers. We know that this last, you know, act, trying out, is worthless, complete waste of time, and we insist that you preclude them from coming on stage. And so if you do, we're going to walk out on you. You know, you're going to ruin the show. We're not going to participate any longer. You know, and you say, wow, you know, as a judge, you're put on the hot seat. And now, who is this last performer that they desperately don't want to get on stage? It's the Christ child, actually. That's the one they don't want to get on stage. Because when that one gets on stage, the talent is immaculate. And you just say, oh, wow, we have a winner. There's no question. See, the others don't want this superior talent to get on stage, period. It's the same story as Cinderella, okay? Same story as Cinderella, where the evil stepmother and her stepdaughters insisted that Cinderella be in rags and be cleaning out the cinders and look all disheveled and ugly and menial slave, because they're terrified that the prince, the spirit, would say, wait, who's that? Wait a minute, I want to see that one too. And they say, no, they're all dressed up in their super fine clothes and jewelry and makeup and attitudes and everything, and they're thinking, oh, the prince is surely going to judge me as the fairest of them all. And the I guess, was it the fairy godmother or something? gave Cinderella a dress or something. But the idea is, let the Christ child get on stage. And the other contestants have formed it's actually a racketeering. The world is really a racketeering racket. It's a racket engaged in racketeering, this planet. All right? This planet is a racket engaged in racketeering. It's insisting, it's blackmailing, and insisting that we don't put the Christ child on stage, because it says, if you do, we're going to annihilate ourselves. We're going to do this. They're threatening. They're blackmailing. As I've said in other videos, we're being blackmailed, especially when it comes to the Christ child. Let it come on stage and let us judge it. Let us view it and say, okay, what's your talent? Let me see that. Okay, 1 second, please. It's that simple. Let it get on stage. Say, look, if you other ones want to quit, whatever. I got to be fair to all contestants. This is a tryout here, and we're judging the contestants. This one wants to get on stage, so I'm going to let it get on stage, and I'm going to see. Yeah, that's the attitude we have to have right now. We are going to let this one get on stage right now. And we don't want to put it off any longer. All those complaints about the other contestants, said, hey, I've made my decision. You're on stage. Next contestant, you're on stage right now.